Welcome to Deep League Diving, the fantasy football podcast dedicated to Deep League dynasty formats and long-term player values. Here's your host, Joe Redmond.
Hi there, and welcome to Deep League Diving. I'm your host, Joe Redmond. You can find me on Twitter at @JAYARR_FF. And I'm joined tonight for the fifth episode in a row. Sean hasn't left me yet. By Sean Emert, my co-host. You can find Sean on Twitter at Ducks with a Z, fan 50. That's 50. Sean, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, Joe. I'm pumped for what we have on tap tonight.
It's an exciting, exciting bit that we're going to be doing. This is actually a podcast first for us. It's our first ever interview that we teased last week. We're hosting linebacker prospect out of Southern Nazarene University, Larry Butler III. I'm super pumped to do this interview, man. I wish you could get on there, but unfortunately, technical difficulties are conspiring against us.
No worries. It was a great interview with him, and it's one of those guys I'm definitely going to be rooting for. I know you're still traveling down to Chicago for the draft this year, right?
This year I can't, unfortunately. It's a huge shame, but I'm going to be able to, you know, cover it a little bit better from the computer and in front of a TV. I wasn't able to live tweet or do any sort of analysis out there on the ground, but I was hoping to, and unfortunately I just don't have the time this year, what with grad school and all that. But it's going to be a fun process no matter what. I know that I have a good feeling that Larry's name is going to get called one of those days on draft day. There's a lot of teams that have been sniffing around him, and for good reason, too.
Yeah, I absolutely hope he goes round three.
We've been seeing a lot of project players go at those mid-round picks the past couple of drafts, too. Round three, round four, round five. I can think of, you know, my hometown Green Bay Packers selecting Richard Rodgers, the tight end, in the third round of the draft a couple of years back, where everyone thought, oh, he's such an unknown name. Like, why would you take a guy like that with your third round pick? But we're starting to see that trend creep up a little more. So I could certainly see that in there.
Yeah, you're definitely seeing the same trend in real NFL as in Dynasty. I mean, I love my third round picks in Dynasty. I think there's so much value there. And it's pretty cool how the Dynasty community reflects a lot of what the NFL's tracking towards, just in how teams are built, et cetera. So it's fun to see it on both sides.
That's always a blast when we can get that sort of verisimilitude of the NFL in our Dynasty leagues. That's why we play it, right? To feel like real GMs. So, but we're here to bring you fantasy content of unknown guys, and Larry Butler III fits the bill perfectly. Hopefully you've heard his name by now, but if you haven't, this interview is going to give you a good intro into the hottest riser out of Division II for the 2016 draft. So let's get into it, Sean. Here is the interview with Larry Butler III. On your own, X go deliver to you. Knock, knock, open up the door, it's real. If the non-stop pop out, I'm stainless steel. Go hard, getting busy with it. Joining us on the show today, for the first time ever, Deep League Diving has a guest. And this guest is a fascinating one, to be sure. Larry Butler III, linebacker prospect out of Southern Nazarene University, has been turning heads in the small school draft community for the past 2-3 years, it seems. And as we get even closer to the 2016 NFL draft, he's continuing to make waves in the draft community. So we'd like to welcome Larry Butler onto the show. How's it going, man?
It's going great. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you for coming on. And we're really excited. This is the first interview ever for us. So it feels like a perfect fit. You're a small school guy, and we're a smaller podcast, so I feel like the mesh is really good here.
I definitely agree.
Awesome. Well, let's dig right in. So speaking of being from a small school program, you spent your whole college career, for the most part, at smaller schools.
What was that experience like playing for small programs like Southern Nazarene and Eastern Arizona, and what did you take away from that?
The thing that I took away from that is, kept me motivated to always work and know that I was always being overlooked, not because of my talent, just because of where I played. And, it just gave me the motivation to go out there, always continue to work hard, prepare, and just get my offs again with football, because I knew that, I wasn't going to have the same exposure or opportunities that some of the guys playing in the SEC, playing at Alabama would have, that I wouldn't have the same opportunities for them. So kind of had to go, put in extra work, not just on the field, but off the field as well.
You can tell that from the play, from watching your play on tape too, whether it was, Oklahoma Panhandle State or, I don't know, some of the bigger schools that you played, you went out there and laid it out every week. I remember watching one of your tape from your junior year, and we talked about this actually a couple months ago, but you played that game with a club on your hand the whole game.
Yes. The majority of the second half of my junior season, I had a broken hand.
And you were going out there and having double-digit tackle games, which is really impressive. Can you speak to how, some people might say, there might be a critique that level of competition isn't as good, and it's harder to translate that game in D2 to the NFL, but you were going out there and being hard-nosed every week. Can you speak to that and how you think that does or doesn't affect how your NFL chances are?
I think that's definitely something scouts take into account. Optimistically, you can view it as a guy who just is super durable, a guy that, a guy that's really hard-nosed and tough, like you mentioned, the guy who just won't let anything stop him. I have one hand. My junior season, second half of the year, I was averaging 14.1 tackles a game with one arm, essentially. That's something that I think should stick out to a lot of people. I definitely think a lot of NFL teams and scouts take that into account. One thing that's been instilled with me since I was little is that I just have a mindset that when I'm on the field, I'm the best. Nothing's going to stop me from performing well. And, that means playing with a club on my arm, Unless something's broken, falling off, like, I'm going to be out on the field and I'm still going to make plays.
I like that attitude. That's good. They might have to Ronnie Lott you and cut a pinky off to make sure you can stay in, but you're going to stay in. talking about injuries, you deliver big hits. You like you said, you had 94 tackles your senior year. Two and a half sacks, 6.5 tackles for a loss too. So you're getting to go up against running backs all the time, and that's one big strength that I've seen of yours on tape, is you have a really good instinct to play the run downhill. But you used to be a running back in high school. So what's more fun? What do you like better, punishing linebackers or punishing running backs?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Definitely miss playing running back a lot. Just, the feel of breaking a long run, just getting in the open field and running. Like, that was a great feeling back in the day. I definitely have to go with the position I'm at now. I love playing linebacker. I love running back.
Yeah. What about playing on the defense is the most fun? I don't know if you know this, but as a fantasy guy, I am a huge advocate of defensive players in general. And so, I love watching defensive tape. What about that position speaks to you?
The best thing about being on defense is just laying the words with somebody, just dropping back in the coverage as a linebacker and seeing a wide receiver come on a slant and they just don't see you coming and you just run full speed into them, just smash them completely, just lay them flat. Like, that's one of the best feelings in the world. Even just, coming on a blitz, the quarterback is just standing right there for you. He has the ball in his hands and you can just, put your head down, run into him full speed and just, hit him. You know, the best thing about being a defensive player is definitely the big hit. You know, there's nothing like that. There's no other feeling like that in the world.
Yeah, I can definitely tell that it would be a good if you need to get any frustration out, don't mess with you during scrimmage. Well, so you've been doing, I know you reached out to me, about a year ago, maybe a year and a half ago, and we've been chatting since then. So you've already been sort of visualizing that draft process and really getting your mind into, this next step into the pro career. But now it's all kind of, hitting the ground running at this point. So can you talk a little about the pre-draft process? You know, what parts you've enjoyed, what's been some tougher parts, and if you can gossip a little, what teams have you spoken to about your draft chances?
Yes, sir. Definitely say the best part about this pre-draft process is definitely just, I enjoyed being at the College Gridiron Showcase. That was a great all-star game in Dallas. Got to finally, because I was supposed to go play Division I football at junior college. A lot of people have heard the story. But to finally be able to play with Division I players in that all-star game, other players of my caliber, guys who were All-Americans like I was, that was a great experience to see how I stacked up. Definitely stood out that week. That was fun. Another great experience I had has definitely been training with TJ Sennett. At Champion Fitness in Georgia, getting the pre-draft training, and I've seen a lot of improvements in everything. Getting bigger, stronger, faster. So that's been fun. I'm on a diet plan. That's been tough. not being able to eat what I normally eat, but I've enjoyed that too. Just everything, just getting ready for the next level. I went to the University of Tulsa's Pro Day. I was the only Division II player that was able to do that. So that was a great experience as well. A bad experience was I pulled my hamstring in the 40-yard dash.
Oof.
But, I still feel like all my numbers, are comparable to any of the top inside linebackers in this draft. And I definitely feel like I'm the best inside linebacker. But, if you look at my pro day numbers, they're on par with anybody in the nation, big school, small school, whatever. And, some of the teams that I've met with in person have been the Seattle Seahawks, the Atlanta Falcons, the Green Bay Packers, Oakland Raiders, Colts, Broncos, Chargers, Cleveland Browns, and Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Trying to think who else came to my school. Talked to the 49ers. That's all I can remember off the top of my head. It's been a couple.
that's some good name drops there, though. And you know that the Packers are near and dear to my heart, so I'm certainly rooting for them to look your way come draft day. Yeah, actually, just for the listeners' reference points, the Larry's pro day numbers were a 4.78 40-yard dash, 27 reps in the bench. That's incredible. 30.5-inch vertical and a 9-foot-2-inch broad jump. So, yeah, if you're running a 4.78 and you pulled your hammy on that one, that's not bad at all. Holy cow. That's solid, man. Yeah, and just to touch on a few other things, too, that you mentioned, Tulsa's Pro Day, I believe I read that 24 professional teams had scouting units there, which is no small shakes. And there are some other Tulsa draft-eligible prospects. I'm sure there were other draft-eligible prospects who were there with you. But that's a big deal to have three-quarters of the league there. That means something, So that's pretty darn cool.
Yes, sir. That's why I said it was such just an amazing experience. And all the Tulsa players were really, really cool. They always welcomed me and they embraced me and everything. I'm really, really thankful to that university and the whole football coaching staff and everything. Personnel people, just the whole University of Tulsa, I just really want to let them know that I was really, really thankful. Honored that they welcomed me and let me participate in their project.
That's fantastic. I'm just pulling up while we were talking here. I was also just pulling up some numbers just for comparison's sake, you know, everybody likes a little recency bias, but the only inside linebackers in 2015's draft class who had similar numbers to your pro day or better were Stephon Anthony, who went in the first round, Bernardrick McKinney, who went high in the second round, Eric Kendricks, who went high in the second round, Ramiq Wilson, who went in the fourth round out of Georgia, and then we've also got Bryce Hager, who was a seventh rounder, I believe, Ben Heaney, who was drafted by the Raiders, and Damian Wilson. So those are all solid names. So don't count out Larry just because of the D2 pedigree. You've got some legit credentials there, my friend. Yeah. So I also wanted to, and I'm sure you've seen John Gruden's quarterback coach room, you know, somewhere along the lines where he'll take a draft eligible quarterback and talk to them and say, look, here's a play. You know, what would you do in this situation? Sort of, you know, get in their mind a little bit to understand them a bit. So I kind of wanted to put you on the hot seat here, if that's okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Awesome. So put yourself in the seat of the Carolina Panthers defense this past Super Bowl. You know, they had played a fantastic game all game, but the Denver Broncos just proved a little too much. C.J. Anderson, the running back for the Broncos, broke off a few too many big runs. What would you have done differently to stop the Broncos, if anything? Or what did you see in the Panthers' defense that sort of reflects your style of play?
Definitely a guy I admire in the Carolina Panthers' defense, among several players on the defense, is just the way Luke Kuechly plays. And if I was in his position as a Mike linebacker, I definitely would have tried to rally the guys and try to tighten things up, maybe even talk to the coach about possibly you know, putting nine in the box, you know, and just really just, you know, just kind of tightening things up defensively in the run game, because that's what we're really killing them. And trying to shut down C.J. Anderson, who's a good back in his own right and everything. But, you know, me as the Michael linebacker, I would have loved the challenge after he had ripped off a few long runs, really trying to shut him down. So that I would have relished that challenge, and I would have hit the field, and I would have just, you know, got into my guys and, you know, give them a speech or whatever, and just, you know, we would have tightened up. And I think that if I was in the middle of that defense, I think we would have definitely, you know, shut down C.J. in the second half.
That sure would be fun playing behind Star Latulele and Kawan Short, though. I'm pretty sure that'd be a fun defense to play in. All right, and I want to wrap up. If you've listened to our show prior, you know that Sean and I, my co-host, like to get a little bit goofy. So I wanted to throw a little bit of a curveball here at you, Larry. For the final question we had for you is, if you could compare your style of play to a genre of music, what kind of music would you be? And it doesn't necessarily have to be the kind of music you listen to, but what do you feel like your style of music is in your play on the field?
I would definitely have to say it's like the 90s New York hip-hop, probably like DMX, just raw, grimy, gritty, you know, real street. That's how I play the game of football, in between the white lines.
That's good. I like that. Some DMX reference. Wow. All right. That's some old school stuff, man. I know that you're a couple years younger than me too, so I wasn't even expecting some of that. That's good.
Yeah.
Cool, man. Well, thank you so much for joining us on the podcast. I, you know, wish you only the best in the coming weeks, and you know, I know that how much you've been working your tail off to get where you are, and it's honestly like a really incredible story. It's going to continue to be an incredible story, because I have a good feeling about where you're going to be sitting at the end of April. And I don't think I'm the only person out there who agrees. I saw you got a name drop from Matt Miller the other day too, which is pretty sweet.
Yeah, I was definitely honored to get mentioned by him.
Where does the process take you from here?
The process will just continue me just staying in shape, training with my trainer in Georgia, as I mentioned before, and just really just trying to turn everything up, you know, times 10 now, just working out instead of three times a day, maybe four times a day, and, you know, just instead of one cheat day with my diet, zero cheat days, you know, just really, really turning everything up and just getting ready for this next level, because, you know, I'm ready to just, you know, ready to come into the league and just shock a lot of people. You know, I have a lot of goals. I would do anything to reach them.
I can tell that just from speaking to you, my man. Well, you can have a couple cheat days for sure once you get drafted, and especially if you're if you come to the Packers up in the Great White North here by me, I will make sure to send you, mail you a bag of gummy bears before kickoff. All right. Well, thank you so much. Larry Butler III, linebacker prospect, coming out this year in the 2016 draft. Thank you again for talking to me, man. It's a blast.
Thank you, sir, for having me. I really appreciate it.
Please, well, the only thing you catch there was came out to play. Stay out my way. We gonna rock, then we gonna roll. Then we let it pop, don't let it go. What? X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. But we gonna rock.
So we've just wrapped up our first ever interview for Deep League Diving. Sean, how are you feeling right now?
It was a great conversation with Larry. I'm excited about his chances, and I hope that he goes very high in the NFL draft. From when I was a kid, I watched the draft start to finish. I did not care how long it took. I mean, back in when I was a kid, they did it in a couple days. Now it's over 3 or 4 days. I don't care. I will watch every single pick every single year, and I've been doing it for 30-plus years. I'm just jazzed. I'm pumped. It's going to make the third, fourth, fifth round interesting. I'll be rooting for Larry. I hope he goes higher than lower, but either way, he's going to get a chance in the NFL. That's what I'm excited about.
Yeah, for sure. And, I mean, he's such a humble, well-spoken, just impressive guy. You know, aside from the tape, like, I've seen his tape, and he's a good downhill run-playing linebacker. He's got some agility that he's shown at the comp or at his pro day. And, you know, aside from how great of a guy he is on the field, you can just tell that he's a genuinely good person off the field too. And I just want to say a huge, huge thank you to Larry for coming onto the show with us. You know, extend again his thanks to the Tulsa football program for hosting him for pro day so that he can get that exposure, because, you know, good people aren't rewarded enough. I don't feel like in the industry that we're in, Sean, or at least that I'm in. I just dragged you into this, so now you have to deal with all of us jerks. But fortunately, you got to talk to a really nice, genuine guy in Larry today, and I think he's going to go good places wherever this route in the NFL takes him.
Absolutely. I'm pumped for him.
So we got to put a little fantasy spin on this to tie a little ribbon on it. Sean, let's say that Larry, you've heard his pro day numbers. We've seen some of his work on tape. How high of a pick in a 7-round IDP league draft would you be willing to take Larry if, say, he goes to the Green Bay Packers? Let's say it's a mid-round pick, that range that we're talking, 3 to 5. Round 3 to 5, he goes to the Green Bay Packers.
I'm in some 12 and some 16. If I'm in a 16-teamer, I'd look 5th round. If I'm in a 12-teamer, 6th, 7th round.
So you're thinking, I mean, in those leagues, in those deeper leagues, sort of mirror his NFL draft value. So watch him on that day, and if you can get him, you know, if he goes to in the 7th round, which we don't hope for Larry as a friend of the podcast, but if he's a NFL value, he might be a value in your dynasty leagues.
I mean, one thing I could say for certain, he's not going to go undrafted in any of the leagues that we're in together.
Not at all. Not in the least. Well, and here's the thing. I have a feeling that he gets his chance on an NFL roster and seizes it. We've heard some really great stories of that happening, especially on the defensive side of the ball in the past. And Larry seems like a guy to see an opportunity and seize it and run with it. So I think all he needs is that little window, and I could see that 7th-round pick, that 5th-round dynasty pick you spend on him, turning into a massive windfall.
Absolutely. I agree with you, Joe.
Awesome, man. Well, this is a heck of a great change of pace for episode 5 here of Deep League Diving. We got to do this more often.
Absolutely. If you had this many friends, this would be easy business.
You saying I don't have friends? So next episode, we are going to dig into our back of the roster analysis again, starting in on the NFC, where we'll get into the NFC East. I'm excited to pan for some more gold in the Dynasty Sandscape, Sean.
Absolutely. NFC East is my favorite division. It's the team. It's the division of my favorite teams, so I know this division pretty well.
But we'll leave that as a, as we say in the biz, a tease for the next episode. So, Sean, thank you for coming on. Big thank you again to Larry Butler III. And thank you all for listening. And, of course, thank you to Nickel Press TV, who continue to have us on their network.
Once again, you can follow me at Ducks Fan with the ZBUCKZFAN50. And I'm on Twitter. Every week I like to drop a little piece of Dynasty advice. And for this week, I wanted to discuss sending out trade offers. I have a 16-team league that I feel like I'm a contender in, and I've already lost Martavius Bryant potentially for the season and Justin Houston. Who knows what's going on with him? They're two huge pieces to the foundation of my team. So as a result of that, it's really making me think about, well, what can I do to improve? What can I do to make this team help this team win this season? So with that being said, I've really looked at like other rosters a little bit deeper and what kind of trades can I make that can be beneficial to both teams, not only myself, but the team I'm trading with. So my piece of advice for this week is to send out more trade offers, because the only way you're going to make trades typically is by pounding the sand. Make those offers and negotiate from there.
And as a reminder, you can find me on Twitter at @JAYARR_FF. You can find all of my writing on numberfire.com or dynastythinktank.wordpress.com. You can find this podcast and more Dynasty information at Dynasty Think Tank or Dino Think Tank on Twitter. So thank you all again for listening to Deep League Diving. We'll catch you again soon.